Next we're going to hear from Dr. Greg Glazov, who's from an organisation called Doctors for the Environment. Yes, when fracking happens, it's the doctors who are among the people who have to clean up the mess from all of the health effects that the industry has. I'll hand you over to Dr. Greg Glazov.
Hello, my name's Greg. I'm a doctor, a general practitioner, and I'm also belong to a voluntary organisation called Doctors for the Environment Australia. And this organisation aims to raise the awareness and address the health impacts arising from damage to our natural environment. At the moment, we're particularly concerned about some very urgent and important issues such as what is happening to our health as a result of climate change and the burning of fossil fuels, the release of pollutants into the atmosphere, and obviously at the moment fracking is an enormous concern to us as well. The World Health Organization states that about a quarter of disease and deaths in the world can be attributed to environmental factors. Basically, we need clean air and water and safe food to meet our basic health needs. With this in mind, we should look with great concern at the rapidly expanding unconventional gas industry, which plans to extract gas from shale by fracking the Perth Basin and large areas of WA. I mean, now, just this morning I noticed on the front page of the West Australian, apparently our Premier has got this forum going where big mining concerns and big business interests pay him $25 a pop at whispering in his ear. 25,000, what did I say? We doctors are also concerned about our health, and I think our branch coordinator here, George Crisp, approached the Minister of Health, Kim Haynes, and we wanted to explain about the probable health issues which are going to arise from the plans of energy development in the state by our government, and they told us that they were not interested. That says something, I think. It is a recent Australian Senate report noted concerns about the potential impacts of the extraction of large volumes of water from aquifers and the risk of contamination of groundwater from toxic compounds and salt, leading to serious and long-term damage to the agricultural productivity on our farmlands. Overseas, this industry's activities have also resulted in air pollution and even triggering of earthquakes. To push through fracking in WA, recently, and without public consultation, the Environment Minister Bill Marmion has sidelined the role of EPA, which will normally oversee environmental safety, instead delegating this task to the Department of Mines and Petroleum, the DMP, which does not have any expertise in this field, let alone the ability to assess the potential health impacts of this activity. Why do we have an Environmental Protection Authority anyway? It is not surprising that the fracking industry hailed this as a great win, which will prevent unnecessary delays for them in a process which they claim to be safe. The problem is safety is one thing that the fracking industry cannot lay claim to. There are some false claims of the fracking proponents, which I will briefly discuss here. Firstly, the industry has claimed that because some of the compounds used in fracking are household chemicals, they must be safe. But because we have bleach and antifreeze in our cupboards, does not mean that we like to drink them. Most of the hundreds of chemicals used to frack are not disclosed on the grounds of commercial interest, as just discussed by Alison. Many thousands of these chemicals are being injected into the gas-bearing formations and left in surface evaporation ponds. BTEX compounds, which I think stands for benzene, toluene, ethylene, xylene compounds, and other compounds such as heavy metals, such as lead, arsenic, etc., salts, and radioactive substances can also be liberated from gas formations during the drilling and extractions, and are especially toxic. For example, the safe level of benzene, which causes leukemia and bone marrow suppression, is just one part per billion, or it's about one drop in an Olympic-sized swimming pool. These substances will hang around in our water supply for hundreds of years to come after they have their after the industry is gone. Secondly, claims that there is no possibility of water contamination are also contradicted by evidence from Australia and overseas, where methane and other chemicals have contaminated groundwater. Have a look at the film Gaslands. These toxic chemicals can migrate into aquifers and groundwater by many ways, including fracture lines and connections between the aquifers, which are not well described, the frequent failure of well casings, and the spillage from enormous volumes of saline fluids filled with these chemicals, which are brought to the surface. So how do you remove these toxic chemicals once they're in our groundwater? Certainly the companies won't be around to do this when this occurs. Thirdly, the industry assures us that it does not threaten food security. But fracking is undertaken in many parts of our prime agricultural areas. Sustainable food production in Australia and food security may be compromised in many ways, from impacts on rivers, groundwater systems, and ecosystems, to increases in water contaminants and salinity, loss of land area to gas infrastructure, contamination of land and damage to soils, and potential contamination of food. One must also note the southwest corner of our state is in a progressive drying state trend due to climate change. Our water is too precious to be permanently fouled by fracking. In Australia, health impacts are not part of any formal assessment process prior to unconventional gas developments. This is despite the fact that risks have not been adequately assessed and, as you can imagine, are potentially very serious and far-reaching. Our body, the Doctors for the Environment Australia, recommends a moratorium on any further approvals of fracking until a comprehensive assessment of risks to health has been conducted. We should have learned from experience with asbestos that we should understand the health consequences of our activities before we rush into new, potentially dangerous industries. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Now, there's already significant opposition to fracking and unconventional gas in Western Australia. We already see when we talk to people on the street that, yes, some people have already heard of fracking and unconventional gas. They've been watching the news, they've seen the furor in the eastern states over coal seam gas, and they've seen the movie Gasland, and they're concerned. They don't want benzene in their water, they don't want to be able to light their tap water on fire. Now, we intend to mobilise this opposition. We intend to mobilise a movement that can stop this industry in its tracks. We're inspired by the example of Lock the Gate in the eastern states, and we're going to do the same thing here. The industry had better watch out. Now, we're in the, at the moment, it's in the lead up to a state election. How foolish of the state government to attempt this in the lead up to an election. They better watch out. We really do commend Alison Xamon on having the courage to actually stand up to this industry, to put forward this motion for a moratorium today. Another round of applause for Alison. Yes, and we're going to win this fight. We're going to win it. You know how I know that we're going to win it? Because we have to. I think this government, this state government and this industry underestimate how far people will go and what people will do to stand up for their water supply. Because really our water supply is our survival. We need water to survive. We need water to grow crops and our food. When your life is at stake or your health is at stake, people will fight tooth and nail. And that's what we've seen over east, and that's what we've started to see down south in Margaret River. Now, already there's been a victory around this campaign in Western Australia. Titan Energy have been forced out of the southwest only just recently. Hooray! And it was the farmers who forced them out. And now the farmers have the support from the city in this group, No Fracking Way. And we're going to mobilise Perth to protect Perth's water supply, but not only just for our own concern, also because we're concerned for the farmers down south and up north, and for the traditional owners in the Kimberley. So yeah, there's a cross-section of society behind this campaign. There's farmers, there's people from all walks of life. There's the people who've come out here today on a work day on short notice to show their support for the motion. And thank you very much for attending. I have to go now. Thank you.
Down, when all the animals have been hunted, when all the waters are polluted, when all the air is unsafe to breathe, only then will you discover that you cannot eat money. Thanks.